Good evening and welcome on board the Election Express. We are broadcasting tonight from a mall in Bengaluru. Quite different from some of the places the Election Express has been to recently, and we are joined at the Phoenix Mall tonight by a cross-section of the citizens of Bengaluru. Thank you so much to all of you for joining us on the Election Express. It's great to be here with all of you. You know, one of the big issues that hit the national headlines when Bengaluru got a chance to vote was the fact that quite a few Bengalurans chose not to vote. And why is that? You know, why didn't people in Bengaluru go out and vote? Harish Bijur, I want to start with you. You are pushing, driving people to go out and vote despite the heightened level of excitement and engagement that didn't translate into heightened vote percentages. Why?
Yeah, Rahul, we tried a lot in Bangalore. Bangalore is a very happening city with a lot of happening people. But as many as 44% of the happening people on the voters list decided not to come out and vote. I think many reasons. One is we had a long weekend. Secondly, I know, inexcusable, certainly, a very long weekend, a slightly faulty voters list to add to it. But overall, you know, I think when you compare it to last year's elections, 2009, the last election, I think there was a blip of 8%. Believe it or not, no long weekend, we'd had another 8% blip actually happening. We are the capital of the outsourcing industry in many, many ways, and Bangaloreans, at least 44% of them, decided to outsource voting to the other 56%.
Well, I know this is a software city and online things are big over here, but there's no option of online voting just yet. But I want to know from the people who've gathered over here, how many of you went out and cast your mandate? How many of you voted? I figured out by now that all those who come for election shows are the ones who've ensured that they went out and voted. The ones who don't come are the ones who are sitting at home laughing, having a good laugh. They're the ones who didn't come out and vote. But why didn't more people go out and vote? You know, you all tried so hard. Why is it that more people didn't vote? Everybody decided to vacation and holiday. The Election Express has been working so hard. Everybody else should be working hard.
Yeah, that's true that only 56% of Bangaloreans came out and vote. But if you see from another perspective, there was an increase of 29% votes polled in 2004.
No, but look at the national averages. Compare it with Delhi. Compare it to the other big cities. More people seem engaged and voting elsewhere than in Bengaluru.
That's true. But if you see the first-time voters, the people who registered newly, we did analytics on 380 booths in Bangalore Central, and we observed that 82% of newly registered voters came out and voted. Whereas the old voters, the repeated voters, there were only 44% who came out.
You're saying it's the old people who didn't come out and vote, the youngsters, the ones who went out and voted?
Yeah, there have been volunteers. There have been a group of volunteers who've been the main reason was the number of people who doesn't have their names in the electoral list. There have been hundreds
of... That doesn't sound like a very good excuse, because if your name is not on the list, you have an opportunity to check beforehand.
We checked it. Hundreds of times people went to BBMP offices, from one office to the other. One answer was, you know, you should not have deposited the form here. You should have submitted somewhere else. The main reason was there were 17 lakh more voters in my constituency only. Out of them, only 14 lakh could enroll. What about the other?
No. Is that something you accept? Or because this whole business of people going on a holiday is not good. You can take a holiday some other time of the year.
Yeah, I agree with you. I can share my experience because I was a booth volunteer for AAP. And I can say that a lot of people came and they were disappointed. I mean, here you push people to go and vote. They come out. Many people didn't have voter ID cards. I mean, they applied, but the application wasn't processed. Many people had voter cards, but their names were not in the list. Even I applied. My application is still under process. And I was always hoping...
Who do you blame for this?
I think the electoral reform has to be done. Election Commission has to look into this. And I think we cannot just blame people went out. There were many people who came but couldn't vote.
Okay. We've sampled the sense that people here at the Phoenix Mall have about why enough Bangaloreans didn't come out and vote. But my colleague Simi Pasha went out and about in the city to get a sense of people, not just those who are here who say they voted, but what about those who didn't vote? What explanations or excuses do they have? At a time when it's become fashionable to vote and completely unfashionable not to vote, what did citizens have to say? Here's what she found out.
It's a city that's in a hurry to get places. No time to stop and think, no time to vote. The IT capital of India may dominate the virtual world, with techies from the city engaging in heated debates on social networking sites. But their engagement with real politics is negligible. The voter turnout this time was an abysmal 53%.
Well, there are multiple reasons for this. The demographics is one of them. It has a huge migrant population. So whenever there is a migrant population, the connection to the city, the emotional connect with the city always tends to sort of come down.
Senior citizens in the city, most of whom are proud voters, claim that youngsters don't realize that every single vote counts.
I don't know, it's the younger generation, you have to blame the younger generation. They don't vote. They one fellow asked, why you are not voting? I'll rather shoot easily. I don't want to vote.
This time there are 4 days holidays now. So most of them, they are left on the Thursday only. And they enjoyed 4 days holidays.
The Election Commission had fixed 17th of April as voting day for Bangalore's 85 lakh voters. It was the Thursday before Good Friday, and the long weekend provided an ideal opportunity for a four-day getaway weekend.
If they had put it in the middle of a working week, in the middle of like Tuesday or Wednesday, I think more younger people would have come. When they got 4 days holidays, everybody just disappeared out of the town.
Outside a high-security IT office, we find some techies taking a break from their computer screens and enjoying a cup of tea. They claim it's too much effort to take time out of their busy schedule and vote when they know that nothing will change.
Maybe people don't have the right person to be voted, maybe.
Even I checked with many of my known people, they were very busy with their actual work.
I think people have lost trust on government, either BJP or Congress.
There are so many scams happening, so people, exactly, they have lost faith in the government, I feel.
Lack of faith in the government and electoral politics is a sentiment that finds resonance among young first-time voters as well. Even though some of them did cast their ballot, they say they understand why the city doesn't care about voting day.
The lower class people who are there, they'll be like, they fight for their vote and all. But the upper class people, they'll be like, why we should vote?
We don't understand now, you know, there's so much politics going on that it's not even clear for us.
I don't believe in politics. There is a right way. I don't vote and all. There is a reason.
Known as the Silicon Valley of India, Bangalore is a preferred destination for IT professionals from across the country. But its lack of interest in electoral politics has come as a rude shock. At a time when places like Muzaffarnagar and Saharanpur in Uttar Pradesh have recorded a voter turnout of 68% and 73% respectively, Bangalore's dismal 53% speaks volumes about the disenchantment of the city's common man with the political class. In Bangalore, with Kasi Siddiqui, Simi Pasha for the Election Express.
Often people in India's big cities complain that there aren't enough good candidates in the fray. This time though, the Congress put up Nandan Nilekani, the Aam Aadmi put up another person from Infosys, Balakrishnan. Does that impact how traditional politicians are viewed? Let me ask some people wearing the Aam Aadmi party caps. Do you think with the presence of Balakrishnan, people like an Anant Kumar or the traditional politicians are made to look outdated or out of fashion?
Yeah, you're right. Not only do not mention only about Nandan Nilekani or V. Balakrishnan. Even our North Bangalore candidate, Professor Babu Matthew, he was the first time, and if you see his credentials, it's awesome. Maybe it's better than Nandan Nilekani or even V. Balakrishnan. And same for our South Bangalore candidate, right? So what you're talking about, if you see the BPAC did a very good thing where they compared all the candidates, and if you see the response, you'll see that how the new candidates were able to defeat others.
Usually one of the things, Rajiv Gowda, that people complain about is that there isn't enough space for new people to come through. You stood for the primaries, we saw Nandan get a ticket. Does that indicate a slight opening of the political door, allowing people from non-political families to come in?
I think politics is opening up. First, there are so many different parties now, and parties are also looking for outstanding people from different professions, different backgrounds, including social service, not just people who are celebrities or people who are industrialists. And so I think this is really a welcome sign, because there are people from elsewhere who are also interested in coming into politics and making a difference to society. So Bangalore is a fantastic example of this. We had across party lines richness of candidates. We had a richness of civil society movements. We had youngsters engaging. And so really, this is, I think, we're on the verge of a transformation in Indian politics, where a lot of people see politics as an avenue for making a significant change.
Okay. Does the presence of a Nandan Nilekani, the presence of a Balakrishnan, dim a Narendra Modi wave in Karnataka, in Bengaluru?
You know, Karnataka has just woken up from a five-year BJP government nightmare. We have a special cell for BJP ministers. We sent Yediyurappa to jail. Janardhan Reddy is still in jail. So BJP and Karnataka just don't gel.
See, it's an inexcusable that we need good candidates in the fray. But parliamentary elections are about parties, is about the party leadership. So forget the candidate, vote for Modi. That's what the candidates are as important. And
but there's a lot of anti-incumbency against Anand Kumar for sure.
Look, Anand Kumar has been in public life. He's been an outstanding minister in the NDA government. He's been a representative of South Bangalore for 18 long years. He's going to win this election as well. The mandate is be with us. We will know on the 16th. My point is the Narendra Modi wave is not a Bangalore-centric phenomena. It's a phenomena that's engulfed the whole of the country, and Bangalore is not away from it. The young, the aged, the professionals have all come out and worked for Narendra Modi, for Anand Kumar, for PC Mohan, for Sadanand Gowda, and they will ensure that on the 16th, these three candidates fly the BJP flag high in Bangalore. Okay?
Does the presence of a Nandan Nilekani, a Balakrishnan, dim supposed Narendra Modi wave in Karnataka?
I don't think there is a Narendra Modi wave, to be honest, because I think now educated middle class people are voting, and they exactly know that you should not be voting for one particular person out there who is projected as Prime Minister, but for what a person has presented in his manifesto and what he's trying to do for his constituency. So I don't think there should be a Narendra Modi wave. That is, it is a very negative trend.
I think we should vote for the person who we are going to hold accountable for. I was considering which party to vote. I work for BPAC, so I carefully observed the comments made by everybody. But at the end of the day, I went back and voted for the person who represented my issues and not the party.
Okay, you're saying, but Bangalore is a very caste-based place, right? So locally, people will say, "Hey, Gidru, yallaru bandhu vote haklebeku. Now Narendra Modi ge vote hakana. Yenante aure togon hogli." That is the attitude. And in
you want to just translate that for us?
Yes, it means that anyhow we need to be ruled. So why not Modi rule us? That's what it means.
No, but
I don't think. I think a lot of people, because of what has happened in 10 years, people are looking for an alternative for Congress. So right now the only option is probably a BJP or not, and hence people are voting for BJP. They're all looking for an alternative for Congress, but not actually for BJP.
No, but you're making a point that you don't vote for a prime ministerial candidate, you vote for the man on the ground. Therefore, someone like an Anand Kumar, his credentials matter also. You can't just say, forget Anand Kumar, vote for Modi.
But you see, in 2009, Congress put up Manmohan Singh as Prime Minister candidate. That time they said, vote for Prime Minister, you know, vote for Manmohan Singh. Now, since they don't have any such person who can be projected as Prime Minister candidate, they are saying vote for local candidate, you know, see local candidate. Of course, local candidate is important, but you have to see, if I vote for Nandan Nilekani, he might be a good guy, but that vote is for Rahul Gandhi, who cannot even manage the country, I think so.
Who cannot manage even an office. I ask the question to people present here, how many of them believe that Rahul Gandhi can be an able Prime Minister?
Okay, let me ask that question then. One second. To the people present over here in Bengaluru, how many people think Rahul Gandhi can be a good Prime Minister? Okay, she's got both her hands up. She's also got a Congress cap up, so that makes perfect sense. Yes, you believe Rahul can be a good Prime Minister. Why do you feel that?
He's a fresh person. He's a fresh person, and he's from the ground level, he has come up.
Yes, I was at the Infosys campus this morning. They said, you don't make an intern a CEO. How can you make Rahul Gandhi Prime Minister?
No, not that way. He has interacted with every section of the person. He has gone to the ground level and worked it. And for the last 10 years, he has worked in UP, and you know the ground level of...
He's fresh, he's clean. Is that enough for Rahul to be PM?
He got the clicks. That's all. What he used always, he go to the poor people, he get the clicks, and frame is there for the people.
He does poverty tourism is the charge, ma'am. You know, Modi keeps saying that Rahul Gandhi likes to show off how poor we are. That's why he invites his foreign friends to places in Amethi, which are so badly.
I want Rahul Gandhi to be the next Prime Minister, because I feel it's time that the young people come up.
Okay, you're saying it's time that young people get an opportunity. Do you agree? Do you think Rahul's worthy of being our Prime Minister?
Well, I don't agree with Rahul being the right candidate for our Prime Minister. And somewhere, the last time I checked, we follow the Indian Constitution, which is a representative democracy, and not the American Constitution, which is a presidential form of government. So why don't we go back to our basics and say, who is the guy who will represent my interests and our interests better in the parliament, and collectively we will have a more representative democracy. So I think this whole bogey of moving from issues to personality has been the most backward thing in this election.
Okay, just one second. I want to ask that gentleman there, do you think Rahul's fit to be India's Prime Minister, sir?
I don't think so, because just clicking, you know, some photographs in some hut or some doesn't qualify one to become a Prime Minister. One has to know the ground reality. One can't.
You've been travelling quite a lot the last 10 years.
That's too late and too little as per me. Again, things like secularism, on which he harps a lot, is not the answer that we're looking for. We're looking for development, we're looking for jobs, we're looking for corruption-free country. That's not the answer. Secularism is not the panache.
Okay, just before coming to the Phoenix Malls, I went across and caught up with Congress candidate here, Nandan Nilekani, a celebrity of sorts in Bengaluru, fought a very tough campaign against the formidable Anand Kumar. He wasn't resting or recuperating. He was doing a full analysis on what he intends to do after the 16th of May, when he hopes the people of Bangalore South would have voted him to power. Here is Nandan Nilekani speaking to the Election Express.
One constant refrain as the Election Express travels through Bengaluru is that Nandan Nilekani is a great guy. Right candidate, but in the wrong party. They say, for what the UPA has done over the last 10 years, there is no way we are going to vote for the Congress, even if we really like Nandan. Most people wanted you to fight as an independent.
No, I think, first of all, in Indian politics, you need to be part of a party if you want to be effective in parliament, because that's the way the system works. And I'm very happy with my choice of the Congress. A Congress ideology, the Congress idea of India, where there's unity of diversity, where everybody, every community has a place. It's really, it's like a, you know, very inclusive party. So I'm very happy with my decision.
No, but given the fact that there's huge anti-incumbents, you would have felt the anger as you went out on the campaign trail, because everyone we spoke to had pretty much the same thing to say, and that really means that the odds were stacked against Nandan Nilekani, the Congress candidate from here.
No, no. First of all, you don't make political choices based on the flavor of the month. You make political choices based on your ideology, and my ideology and the Congress ideology are identical, and therefore I'm very happy with my choice. I'm confident I'm going to win this election. So I'm fine.
In the end, do you think it became a Nandan Nilekani versus Narendra Modi contest? It's not so much Anand Kumar's presence over here, but the fact that there is also an underlying desire in Bangalore to see Modi SPM. And therefore, there was good candidate Nandan, bad party Congress, versus not so good candidate Anand Kumar, but great candidate Modi.
No, no such thing. The fact of the matter is that Anand Kumar was a very weak candidate. He had, you know, hide behind the coattails of some chief minister to, you know, try to even get in the election. So that is the reality. But our campaign was focused on issues of Bengaluru, Bengaluru's challenges about water, about transportation, about education, about women's safety. And I think that campaign struck a chord. No,
because you are very clearly trying to localize the election. But people would say that an MP doesn't really have anything to do with local municipal issues. The task in a Lok Sabha election is to appoint a Prime Minister.
No, no, no. I think every MP has to do something. There's something to be done for Bengaluru. Whom are you going to call? You have to call an MP who's competent. So I think people have got that message, and I'm very confident, and you'll see on May 16th, that the people will definitely make
because
the right choice.
There are two different appeals. One is Nandan Nilekani saying, localize the election. Narendra Modi saying, forget the candidate, vote for me. I'm the election, vote for me. And that seems to have caught on too, because there's a lot of appeal in the idea of a virtual President Modi.
I don't think so. There was absolutely no wave. The only wave in town was the anti-Anand Kumar wave. There was no other wave in town.
Okay, why is there so much gloom and doom around the Congress campaign at this time?
No, there's no doom and gloom. There's only
not around Nandan Nilekani's campaign. But generally, the Congress campaign nationally simply failed to take off.
No, I think it's doing fine, and I think you'll be surprised by the results.
Because there are lots of people now clamoring for Priyanka Gandhi to be given a more active role, saying that you really need fortification, you need reinforcements.
No, I think the Congress campaign is doing very well. I'm getting good reports from around the country.
Okay, and what's your sense? Will there be a UPA 3, or are you reconciling for a term in opposition?
No, I'm looking forward to the Congress playing a very important role.
There's a big meeting that you need to go back into, Mr. Nilekani. Thank you very much for joining us on the Election Express, and I wish you all the best.
Thanks, Rahul. Thank you for having me.
Constituency management system sounds like a great idea.
Thank you.
And this should surely be replicated all across. Thank you so much for joining
us.
Rahul.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a good trip.
Thanks.
That was a very confident Nandan Nilekani. A gentleman here has a question based on the Nandan interview. Yes, sir.
Well, somebody in South Bangalore asked him this question, and they said if Rahul would apply for a job at Infosys and Nandan was the CEO, based on Rahul's abilities, where would he place him in Infosys? And therefore, how would Nandan report to Rahul as Prime Minister?
And what did Nandan say?
I think he just laughed it off. I don't think he really had an answer for that.
Yeah, I have a counter to that. You know, Nandan should not laugh it off because his mentor, Narayan Murthy, has parachuted his son to the top of Infosys. Maybe he needs to start working with Rahul in the same way.
He is working with Rahul in the same spirit. No, but that's a very important question. And you're a very qualified professional yourself, sir. Given the experience that you have, your educational qualification, your teaching experience, why should you be reporting to Rahul Gandhi and not vice versa? Why should Nandan Nilekani be reporting to Rahul Gandhi and not vice versa?
Yeah, Rahul Gandhi can be seen as part of the founding team of Infosys, right? That's the way...
Rahul Gandhi, founding team of Infosys?
I'm giving you a parallel. Okay, that's how Nandan and his team also came up and ran the company. So Rahul belongs to a family that has built the Congress party, built the nation.
Like Rohan.
And, well, I don't want to comment on Murthy's choices. But
it's similar.
Forget these kinds of issues. Think about what...
No, but you must answer his question. Where would Nandan Nilekani employ Rahul Gandhi if he was CEO of Infosys?
It would be the other way. Rahul Gandhi would give Nandan Nilekani an opportunity.
It's like a family-owned enterprise.
Not at all. It's a national movement.
But that's what Infosis said they didn't stand for.
No. Dinesh? Yeah.
See, Mr. Rahul Gandhi is a two-term member of parliament. He's worked throughout the country, he's travelled. He is the leader of the party today. He is the vice president of the Congress.
Is Amram Digvijay Singh have much more experience than
him? He has the abilities. He has been speaking all over the country on many issues, not just about secularism, about development, about issues facing the country. So he has shown his abilities.
Harish Bijur, where would Nandan employ Rahul Gandhi? I'm not getting a good answer.
Poor Nandan, poor Rahul Gandhi. I'm not going to answer for either of them. But I'm just going to say one thing. You know, treat this to be an entrepreneurship at the end of the day. The Congress party is an entrepreneurship. And the Congress party needs a family name. At the end of the day, the Gandhi name works and it works. So I think, that's why Rahul Gandhi is where he is at this point of time. I'm apolitical on this issue, but I'd just like to say that entrepreneurships are important and people who run businesses are different people. People who are start...
But Mukesh Ambani's son must demonstrate he's worthy of being an inheritor to Dhirubhai and Mukesh Ambani's business if he wants all those people to report.
Well, let me put it this way. If you have the right name, I think this country can run on the right name. It's been proven in the past.
How many people... Is that a notion now buried in history? I want to ask people here, how many people here, and there are lots of people standing at the back, feel free to join in this broadcast, how many people here believe a title, a surname, is a good enough qualification to be CEO of India? How many people believe that? Even Rajiv Gowda is not putting his hand up. Do you, sir, even you are not putting...
You have to look for what they stand for, right? Let me finish it. So Rahul and Sonia...
You are dodging.
Rahul and Sonia Gandhi stand for empowerment and stand for transformation of the country.
I'm asking a question. One second. I'm asking a question. Harish Bijur, you must put your hand up because it's your theory. How many people here believe that a title or a surname is a good enough qualification to be Prime Minister? No one. How many people believe it's not a qualification and you need much more than that? How many people believe that a title is not good enough?
You know, it's rather unfortunate that we're discussing Rahul Gandhi as a potential Prime Minister of this country when there are so many more young, qualified people, even in the Congress party.
Who do you think is more qualified than Rahul?
Anybody. Just pick up anybody. Throw a stone in Congress party and it hits the next young guy. He's more competent.
How is Jyotir or a Milind more qualified?
For the last 10 years, you had Dr. Manmohan Singh as the Prime Minister of the country. Yes. Did Sonia Gandhi become the Prime Minister of the country? Did Rahul Gandhi become a minister in the cabinet? No. So Congress has empowered people. Congress has empowered.
Have you read Sanjay Baru's new book, The Accidental Prime Minister? That has a lot of answers to this. I just want to go back. Yes.
I would say from last 10 years, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi are ruling the country. It's not Manmohan Singh.
No, but they're not ruling by being Prime Minister. Yes, ma'am.
Definitely not. A surname is just not good enough. And I would say that, last 60 years, it has been a disaster just being ruled by the Gandhi name. And the country is definitely in for a change and we're not looking at names anymore.
And if you're talking about MPs like Milind Deora, there has been instances where we have seen he has gone away from the party for certain development things. So why not support someone even in Congress who's better than Rahul Gandhi?
Okay, that's a very interesting discussion. I want to go back just to that one gentleman over there. What's your view, sir? Do you think a title is good enough to be Prime Minister of India?
No, I don't think so. Especially with Rahul Gandhi, when he got the chance as the Vice President of Congress, when he said we want 9 cylinders, by evening government cleared that notion. But we had got a chance to act against corruption, to act against Mr. Chauhan in Maharashtra, and so many scams happened. There was no action by Mr. Rahul Gandhi.
Okay. Thank you so much. A very spirited performance of the Yakshagana by Soumishri. Thank you so much. Really nice having you with us. Thank you so much for joining us on the Election Express. Thank you. On part two of this program tonight, I want to ask people present over here with us in Bengaluru on the Election Express, how many people here believe that there is a Narendra Modi wave in Karnataka and in Bengaluru? How many people believe that? How many people believe there is no Narendra Modi wave? No wave? Why do you feel there's no wave?
Oh, I've been watching media, I've been watching televisions regularly for the last 1 year. There is absolutely no wave of Modi at all in Karnataka. Maybe a little bit of here and there in Bangalore, which is absolutely stupidity. For me, when somebody has been handing over entirely to one single person, that's going to be the point of failure for this country. And we see, if everything is only Modi, actually, one more thing. It was shameful to see all the BJP candidates in Karnataka were coming to the stage and saying, please vote for Modi, don't vote for me. What the hell is this? It's
a total disgrace to the candidates who are standing for the elections on behalf of BJP.
You're saying that the candidates are disgracing themselves by saying, vote for Modi, not for me. Do you think he's actually taken over the party, hijacked the entire system, made everyone subservient?
I don't know why people don't understand that they are electing 500 MPs. And Modi has to work along with them. So there is no one person here. And Modi is the man for India today. He is the person for this great country. He has to take us forward. He is the bridge for the next 10 years for this country. Do you think Congress is a bridge? This congressman is telling. Do you think Arvind Kejriwal is a bridge? My goodness, impossible.
You're saying Arvind Kejriwal is not up to the task. Do you believe, sir, that there is any form of a Modi wave, or do you think there's a big Kejriwal wave blowing over here?
See, the first thing is that if you go out and talk to the people outside, not just in the TV studios, you will see that
that's why we are here, outside, with you.
It's about the issues, it's about water in Bangalore, it is about traffic in Bangalore, and there is no Modi wave on the ground. It is there in the studios. I have campaigned and I know this.
So you're saying that he's saying basically to all of you that the Modi wave is only in the studio, not out in the ground in Bangalore.
Okay, I just want to counter both of them. They said that they have been watching in the TV. I have been talking for 2 years to all the people, and when they hear Modi name, they smile. Yeah. So it's not about sitting and watching in the TV. I have been talking to so many people in my office, on the ground, on the street.
These elections are not about, you know, meri Gandhi Nali or, you know, the kuda outside my home. This is about India first. This is the national issues. We have to talk about the unemployment. We have to talk about the development, about the women's security. These are the reasons that we are supporting.
Okay, is there a Modi wave here?
I believe the Modi wave is valid for people who believe in facades, who get carried away by rhetorics. For those
let him speak. You can't shout him down. Allow him to speak.
For those who like to reason it out, I don't think there is a Modi wave around. So
why do you feel that there's no Modi wave?
No, I personally like to look at candidates, look at individuals, and vote accordingly. So for me, it's
okay. Is there a Modi wave or not?
Yeah, I would say there's a Modi wave for sure. But if you're talking about rhetorics, etc., then Arvind Kejriwal is a better example than Narendra Modi. We have been seeing various sort of hypocritic statements from him. He gives a clean sheet to each of his members, but then again accuses others without any proof.
But Arvind Kejriwal seems to have conceded defeat. He's already saying that we made a big mistake by giving up power after 49 days. Why is it that even Manish Sisodia this evening said that the fact that we gave up power has negatively impacted our national fortunes? It almost seems as if the Aam Aadmi Party is conceding defeat before the results are out. Why is that, sir?
That's not the case. If you remember,
I'm going by your leaders, and that's what they're saying.
Yeah, that's what I'm answering. If you go by the statement which he made in the past also, he has said that the mistake which we made is we did not communicate properly. He did not say that leaving power was a mistake. The mistake was we did not communicate properly. So there's a slight distinction between them.
No, because Manish Sisodia said this evening that the fact that we gave up power in the way that we did impacted our national fortunes. Do you think the Aam Aadmi Party lost the goodwill that they created?
To a great extent, yes. First of all, Aam Aadmi Party is a party which was elected to power on an experimental basis based on a bunch of promises. Okay, they have crumbled under their own weight. They have made promises they are no longer able to perform. They are unable to keep those promises, which is why on their own they exit before they were chased out. Now, who decides who is the PM? It is the MPs who are elected by the people, and the MPs are the elected representatives of the people. And if the MPs collectively decide it's going to be Rahul Gandhi, that is the national choice. Whoever it is, what is his disqualification? Just because he is from the Nehru Gandhi family, that is his disqualification, is it? I don't understand. This is, they are just being, this is favoritism. In anti-incumbency factor multiplied by two, that is what is happening. You know, it is only people who perform who come under criticism. Please let us note this fact, okay? It is people sitting in office.
Rahul is being criticized because he performed. Is that the case? Let me get a word in from here. Because there are two terms of anti-incumbency, therefore naturally people will be fed up with whoever is in power.
No, that's not the point. See, Narendra Modi epitomizes hope. And this election is being fought on hope for a better India, for a better future. It is not about anti-incumbency against the Congress or the Rahul Gandhi. They're not even in the equation today. People are looking at Narendra Modi to deliver basics.
Mr. Gowda, that's an important point. Narendra Modi has been able to stitch a narrative of hope, whereas with the Congress, there is despondency, there is paralysis, there is negativity, whereas Modi has been able to stitch and build hope.
I think people need to take a step back and look at how things have changed over the last 10 years, how we've brought 14 crore people out of poverty. You need to pay attention to the extraordinary prosperity in rural India. You need to think about those who were left behind and who got a social safety net. You need to have a heart for the Indians who have not had a chance.
The gentleman has a question for you. Yes, sir.
No, what about jobs? There are no jobs if you compare NDA and UPA.
Even by the government's own figures, the UPA's period in power has mostly been a period of relatively jobless growth.
No, that's not true at all.
Those are the Planning Commission figures, sir.
No. Are you telling me that India grew at 8%?
The Planning Commission figures are telling you that. I'm not telling you.
I'm telling you that all of us became so spectacularly productive. No, lots of things changed in the way we measure employment and unemployment. So that's a different debate altogether. The basic point is, look at every measure, right? 7% plus average growth over the last 10 years. A Sensex that has gone up fourfold, which means that industrial...
Now the Sensex is going up in the hope that Modi is coming to power.
No. In which case, you better sell fast while you can still make your money, because Modi is not going to come to power.
Rahul, if you ask me, this election is certainly one of hope. If you ask me, is there a wave? There is certainly a wave of hope. There are people talking about a Modi wave. I'm not sure if it's there. There are people talking of an anti-incumbency wave. I'm not sure that it's there. There certainly was a heat wave in Karnataka. But the point is, it is a wave of hope. And I think hope is what is going to be on the side of the BJP for sure.
Saying that hope is what the BJP is riding. Earlier in the day, we went to the Infosys campus, 80 acres, 26,000 employees, to get a sense of what some of the brightest minds in India have to think about the battle for your vote 2014. Here's the poll pulse we shot at the Infosys campus this afternoon.
You all, I see, don't like the Congress, think there have been too many scams over there. You are disenchanted with the Aam Aadmi Party. So is there anyone Infosys likes or people over here like, or everyone is useless and good fun? Yes.
Add to what they said. I think it's not just about a party, and it's not about one person who's taking care of the entire aspect for a huge country like ours. It's about all the people who are going to rule the people from various cities, various states of India, and those people's credibility also need to be taken into consideration. And I think if you look into the various people who are in the hierarchy in Aam Aadmi Party, they have already built the credibility not by being into the same political party and getting into promotion for last 30 years, but being into some genuine contributions and giving a perspective to the people that they know what is a real issue.
Also, why is everyone so disenchanted with the Aam Aadmi?
That's their opinion. I'm just saying.
You are not disenchanted. She is not disenchanted. Yes.
See, I probably think that Aam Aadmi Party has given us a third choice. You know, it's caused a kind of revolution.
Yeah.
People only had BJP and Congress. Now they know there is something else to go for it. So this is a very new party. By the time another 10 years, give them 10 years, 5 years, 10 years time, and then we might see a different, you know, Arvind Kejriwal. The one mistake what I feel he did was to jump into Lok Sabha elections too soon. So now that you have got a power, you got the power, you show to the people that I can actually rule. I can be a leader.
How many people here like the BJP but are concerned about the RSS? Yeah. How many people are concerned about the RSS? Why are you concerned about that?
See, I think I personally enjoy my freedom, and no, I don't want anyone to come and teach me what to do and what not to do. And I think recently, I think Karnataka, Mangalore, you must have heard about these Ram Sena and, you know, the radical activists of the right-wing groups which are associated with the RSS. And so I think I'm more scared of that. And and having a leader like Modi, he maybe is a strong leader, but he has under him people like Amit Shah, you know, who had recent remarks in UP, and now we have Pramit. So I think I feel a little scared that, you know, he will basically destroy the integrity of this country.
Do you see a threat to women's lib? You were a big Modi fan.
With him, I don't think that RSS is, they are Swayam Sevaks, and no one teaches anyone to do anything. They are Swayam Sevaks who serve people. My dad is a RSS supporter. He is an RSS from many years, and I feel their values are much greater than the common man.
No, but that point that lady raises, which is that individual freedoms could be a threat. That's the concern she raises.
Absolutely agree with what he said, because here the RSS philosophy is kind of limiting. And it somewhere gives the perception that you need to go by a certain philosophy because people say that is right, which is not the case, because there is no extreme like right or wrong.
All the Modi fans must answer this. Yeah.
The people are getting confused between RSS and Ram Sena. Okay, RSS is a certain ideology, but that incident was done by Ram Sena, right?
But they're all part of the same gang. When there's a big RSS meeting, Mutalik and all are also invited. Praveen Togadia is invited to every big RSS meeting. So they are part of the same family.
Praveen Togadia gave some speech that is in public, Modi has desisted that.
But are you not reassured by the fact that Modi criticized Togadia, Giriraj Singh for saying what they said, saying that I don't agree with that?
Well, he might be the PM, but can he control every person in the party, every outfit?
But he's not possible. At the end of the day, Modi.
One more thing. Religion is a very private thing. You can't come and impose any principles of any religion on anybody. Agreed, the majority religion in India is Hinduism or Sanatana Dharma, but then you can't really take that as the basis of your party, political party and propaganda.
I would completely agree with her, actually. BJP would come with its own baggage, whether we like it or not.
You can watch the rest of the poll pulse we shot at Infosys at 10:45 p.m. In the last part of this program, I want to ask some of the young people who are joining us watching from the sidelines, who do you think is best suited to take India into the future and to take care of the needs and aspirations of the youth of India?
Well, it's definitely Narendra Modi, because the Gujarat development model and the whole Modi wave is being debated because they are debatable topics. There's no debate about Amethi development model or Rahul Gandhi wave simply because it doesn't exist. So Modi is definitely the person to take us forward, and my vote is for him.
The fact that a Modi model exists, or at least can be debated, is true, because there is no Rahul model of development in Amethi, for example. We went to Amethi, the Election Express was. That's a complete mess. They're saying at least in Modi and in Gujarat, there's a model which can be debated. With Rahul, that's not even the case.
See, the model which you have to discuss is the UPA model. Because we have run the country for the last 10 years. We have ruled this country for the last 60, after independence for 60 years. You mean to say India is in a bad shape today? India doesn't have respect in the world? Who's done all this?
How many people think India is in a bad shape today? Sir, I think... Why are you putting your hand up? You're in the Congress.
No. So, the model is the UPA model. Our manifesto was the first to come out.
No, but a lot of people here think that India is in a bad shape. You think India is doing good. The government, Congress thinks India is doing well. India thinks India is not doing well.
No, these are all the AAP supporters and BJP supporters. So, if today India is a growing country, it's a growing economy, under Rajiv Gandhi, under Narasimha Rao, under Manmohan Singh.
Once again, the gentleman insists on responding to what you're saying. Just one second. Yes, you're a localite. What are you saying, sir?
This is very well planned from AAP and I think from BJP. If we could have also brought many thousand people from this area or any from part of Bangalore and we could have fought. And you're saying there are many people rising up for AAP and Modi. There is nothing like that. Rahul Gandhi is the right person to lead this country and is the is and there is no Modi wave. All there. Some of the TV channels are promoting
and
Modi.
Just, I think this is well planned. This is well planned and I don't believe in this.
Yes, yes, madam. This is well planned. This is well planned because we don't know. We could have also brought thousand people, thousand Congress workers who can support.
We put out, we put out on social media inviting.
Stop this. This is not the, you should stop this. This is not the right thing. You should stop this. We could have also brought thousand people, okay? I think this is very well planned.
No. We invited everyone equally.
You have seen the Congress. So this is the real Congress that we have here. This is the real Congress that we have, you know.
No, you must allow.
No,
one second. I will not be bullied by anyone.
You are searching for a wave in a tsunami. There is a Modi tsunami and not Modi wave. Understand that. And about UPA model, there exists a UPA model and the major salient feature of that is corruption.
No, one second. I want to go across to the third front, the Janata Dal also. Sir, you've been waiting for an opportunity to speak. What do you in the... Hey, Mr. Gandhi fans, please, silence. Relax, sit down.
Yes. See, I'll tell you one thing. He rightly said that there is Modi tsunami. Tsunami is destructive. And Modi doesn't exist in Karnataka at all. I have traveled the length and breadth of the state. Modi doesn't exist at all. And talking about Congress, yes, definitely it is in a sad state. The future of Karnataka politics and the national politics belongs to the third front. The third front is going to be the major power where we are going to rule not by two individuals, Rahul Gandhi, neither Rahul Gandhi nor Modi. It is going to be somebody else, strong, capable.
Okay, I want to go across to a very astute observer of politics over here in Karnataka, ma'am. I want to understand from you how important, how deep do you feel the Modi wave is in Karnataka?
See, I tell you the wave is already there. Everyone knows about it. Like Valmiki Rama, you know, they never wanted to say Rama, Mara. Then they went on repeating. Whether they like it or not, Modi is a problem. Everyone's tongue, it is the Modi. Now I tell you one thing. See, now India has become a sinking ship. We have to raise it. We need a good captain. Who is a good captain? It is only Modi. Because we want India to become the superpower. Who can begin? It can be done only by a superman. And that superman is nothing but other than Modi.
Why do you think Modi is a superman?
Yes, he's a visionary. Because I tell you, in our constitution, 1935 constitution came. It has been copied by our constitution in the constitutional assembly. 235 articles have been copied. While along with the copying, they have copied the administrative rules and the judicial rules, which has to be revamped. Entire thing has to be revamped. Okay. That's the reason why we want Modi.
Why does Modi the Superman need an Adani plane to fly? I don't understand.
Why does Modi the Superman?
Because Kejriwal needs an India Today group to fly, plane to fly.
We need system dependent, not person dependent. When Modi has not handled his wife properly, how can he handle the country?
Okay, one second, you must respond. He is raising a point about the Adani planes that Modi flies.
I don't think that is an issue at all. Modi stands for development in this country. Arvind Kejriwal has been doing, there is one problem with Arvind Kejriwal. He has been laying a false conspiracy against Modi, saying that Modi is attached to Adani. Apart from this, there is no other campaign by Arvind Kejriwal. But one thing is sure, Modi, Arvind Kejriwal is a man who will run away from this country in 49 days. Remember,
ma'am, yes, quick final comment.
I don't want anyone to use this platform to harm a woman. So far as Modi is concerned, his right to privacy is constitution guarantee to any woman. He is protecting the wife and her rights. No one in the world has got the right to condemn Modi or his wife. I am ashamed of our people calling so far the women are concerned. It is impossible. Right to privacy is guaranteed under the constitution. Please remember that.
I don't know who's a superman and who is not. But I know one thing for a fact, that you all have been a super audience. Thank you so much for joining us in Bengaluru tonight. It's been absolutely brilliant.
One last line, AK-49 we know, right? How he did. He ran away. So what do you want? You want your PM also to run away?
No, everybody must get a CM. Modi is also running away from his CM post, for your kind information.
In alphabets, there will be A to Z, not Z to A. A means AAP, B means BJP, C means Congress.
And how the corruption done by the BJP is different from Congress, at least I am not able to understand. Yes. Even in the Modi's cabinet, there are ministers who are convicted by the court.
Okay, I want to end with a good message from our band. Yes, we're out of time.
I think we're not asking the right questions. We need to ask who's funding the campaigns, who's funding each candidate, who's funding... So these are systemic issues. Who's bringing this vision out? There's nobody talking about it.
Okay, quick final comment, sir.
Rahul, I'm in closure, I would like to say the Election Express is here and you have made Bangalore a happening hub. But let's hope one thing, that this entire audience stays alive for 5 years and more. By that I mean, this election has excited people, has made people step out and vote. I hope this enthusiasm remains open right through the...
I think those are great words to end this program on. That the level of engagement that we've seen must continue. And I hand the stage once again to the band who's joined us. Thank you all so much for joining us. You've been a fabulous audience. We've got a long night ahead of us. We're driving all the way to Hyderabad and we'll be broadcasting the Election Express tomorrow in the evening from Hyderabad. Thank you all so much for joining us on this broadcast.